I'm happy one more time to be back with you where I can give a word of encouragement. I just want to say thanks again to our sister Angela for allowing me this opportunity. You know, God has been good and faithful to us, and we ought to give him praise this morning. I'm going to talk this morning a little about the tomb is empty. Yes, we are coming out of the resurrection season, you know, where everybody was celebrating Good Friday and Easter on the first day of the week when the ladies went to the tomb. And we understand that Jesus Christ is no longer in the grave, but he rose triumphant on that resurrection morning. Now, there's two passages of scriptures I'm going to look at. Matthew 28, 12 to 15. And the reading says, "And when they were assembled with the elders and had taken counsel, they gave large sum of money unto the soldiers, saying, Say ye, his disciples came by night and stole him away while we slept. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will persuade him and secure you. So they took the money and did as they were taught. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day." The next scripture I'm going to look at is Mark 16, verse 6. "And he said unto them, Be not affrighted. Ye see Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they lay him." Praise the name of the Lord. God is good. And we all can attest to the fact, according to the word of God, that the tomb where Jesus was laid is empty. The tomb was found empty. Now, we have two reports about the empty tomb. The first passage of scripture tells us that when the men that was guarding the tomb found out that the tomb was empty, they went to the elders and the priests and reported this. And even though the elders and the leaders in those days knew the scriptures and they heard what Jesus prophesied, they want to make themselves look good. And they say, "We will give you a large sum of money for you to say his disciples came by night while you were sleeping and stole his body away." And that is commonly reported among the Jews until this day, that Jesus' disciples stole his body. Now, the next account was very early in the morning. Mary Magdalene, out of whom Jesus cast seven devils, got her spices and she went to the tomb. There were the other Marys with her. And as they traveled along, they talked among themselves, "Who will roll away the stone from from the sepulchre. Because it was a huge stone placed there to secure the tomb. Now, the reason for securing the tomb was the people that placed Jesus after they crucified him and placed him in the tomb, the leaders knew and they believed within himself he was going to burst the tomb. And they said, let make this tomb secure. For this deceiver said, destroy this temple and I will raise it again on the third day. So they knew and they understood what they were doing. While the women was going along, thinking about who's going to take the stone away for them, the angels rolled the stone away. The Bible said when they got to the tomb, the stone was rolled away, and there was a man sitting on the tomb. When the ladies got there, he said to them, I know you seek Jesus of Nazareth. He is risen as he said. See the place where he lay. Go tell the disciples he has gone before you into Galilee. Now, the women, they found the tomb open. And when they got there, before they could get even to look into the tomb, the man that was sitting on the stone approached them and began to talk to them. And he told them about the risen Lord. He's not here. Take a look at where you laid him. The women, they look. They saw the napkin that was wrapped around his head. They saw the linen clothes, but they did not see a body. The tomb was empty. Now the thing is, since we all understand that the tomb was empty, whether his disciples stole the body away or whether he rose by himself, we know the tomb was empty. The important thing is, which story do you believe? Do you believe the reports given to the women by the angel that he rose on his own accord and he gone before them into Galilee? Or do you believe the report of the elders? Say his disciples came and stole his body while you slept. Now, I have a problem with that because the soldiers were put there to guard the tomb. They're supposed to be working. Why would they be sleeping? And if they're sleeping, why is it the elders want to pay a large sum of money to say they were sleeping when they should be working? They were watchmen. So, again, I ask, which story or which account do you believe? Because the tomb is empty. Now, we hear Isaiah in Isaiah 53 ask the same question. Who have believed the report? Now, what report do we want to believe? Isaiah prophesied about him. He said he was rejected of men. He was a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief. We hid as it were our faces from him. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter and a sheep before his shears dumb. And he openeth not his mouth. He was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Now we want to believe the true report. And that true report is he rose as he said he would. The disciples didn't have to take his body away. He had power to lay down his life. And he said, I have power to take it up. No man take my life from me. I laid it down and I take it up. His body was not stolen, as the report was given by the elders, but he rose triumphantly from the grave. And the Bible said he came forth crying, all hail, all power is given unto me. I have the keys of death and I have the keys of hell. So he rose on his own accord because of the power that was given him of his father. Now we have Luke giving his account in Luke 24, 13 to 31. Jesus did not only arose and stay there. He did not hide. He made himself visible. He made himself known to people. And this particular passage of scripture tells us that two of the disciples, they were walking down the road on Emmaus, and they were talking about the thing that had taken place at Jerusalem, how he was crucified. And as they communed among themselves, the Bible said that Jesus appeared to them and he listened to their conversation. He says to them, what manner of communication you are having? What happened? And they begin to tell him about Jesus of Nazareth that was crucified, how he was led from judgment hall to judgment hall, how Pilate released him, and how they crucified him. And as they begin to talk about what went on, they says to him, wait a minute, are you a stranger here that you do not know these things? And as they went on, Jesus began to open up the scriptures unto them. The Bible said, beginning from Moses and the prophets, he began to talk about the things that the Bible spoke of concerning him and the death that he would have died. They said, as he went on and the evening began to dawn, Jesus made it as if he was going to go further into the city. And the men said, no, it's late. And they restrained him that he would stay with them. And Jesus, he went in with them. And as there was day, the Bible said he took bread and he broke it. And he gave it to them. And their eyes was open. And they knew him. And as their eyes was open and they knew him, he disappeared from them. So Jesus made himself known to those two disciples that went down the road of Emmaus and the breaking of bread. So yes, Jesus was seen walking the earth after his resurrection. He did not hide. He made himself public. Again, another time, his disciples were sitting. And as this disciple sat in this closed room, behold, Jesus appeared to them. No one opened the door for him. He had power enough that he could appear even when the doors and the windows are closed. He will appear in your midst. What are you going through today? What am I going through today that we need to invite Jesus to come into our midst and commune with us? As Jesus went in the midst of his disciples, he didn't wait on them. He says to them, behold my hands, behold my feet. It is I. handle me and see, for a spirit has not flesh and bone as you see me have. In other words, he was telling them, it is me in human form again. It is not my spirit. I have risen from the dead as I promised you I would. So this morning, the tomb is empty. The report is true. He is no longer there. He is risen as he said he would. And he went before his disciples into Galilee. Don't believe the lie. His body wasn't stolen. He rose on his own accord, as he said he would. He walked out and he left the grave closed. He was first seen of Mary Magdalene. Then he showed himself to the other disciples. Now the scripture said one of his disciples wasn't there. So he appeared to 10 of them. Thomas was not there when he appeared to the others. And when the other disciples saw Thomas, they told Thomas, we have seen the master. He's alive. The tomb is empty. Peter could attest to that. Because when the women went and told the disciples, Peter and John, they ran to the tomb. The Bible said John outran Peter, but being timid, he did not go into the tomb. But Peter, when he got there, ran straight into the tomb. The body was not there, only the linen clothes and the napkin. And Jesus made himself known to them. Yes, I'm alive. The tomb is empty. I have power to do all things, and this power is given unto me of my Father. Thomas, he did not believe. So Jesus appeared a second time to the disciples, and Thomas was present. Jesus says to Thomas, as reported in John 20, 27, then said he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger and behold my hand. Reach hither thy hand and trust it in my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And the word said, when Thomas heard that, Thomas said, my Lord and my God. Thomas believed the story because Jesus said, see my hands, see my feet, put your hand in my side. His hands were scarred with the nails. He was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for us. He took our place on Calvary. He wore a cross that was a crown that was meant for us. He bore a cross that was meant for us to carry. He was placed in a borrowed tomb. And he came forth victorious. Today we can say, because he lived, we can face tomorrow. Because he lived, we will live also. Because he lived, we will rise with him one day in glory. And as Jesus said, he would raise from the dead, and he rose. He told his disciples he was going away, and he was coming back again. He said, in my Father's house, there are many dwelling places, and I will go to my Father, and I will come back. I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, you will be also. Therefore, let not your heart be troubled concerning the things that are going on, but believe in God. Believe also in me. And he said he is coming back. The Bible tells us after 40 days with his disciples walking among men, he was taken away from them as he commissioned them to go back to Jerusalem and wait for the endowment of the Holy Spirit. While talking to them, he was taken up into heaven. And the angel said, "Ye men of Galilee, as you watch Jesus going up, he's coming back in like manner." Yes, as Jesus said, "I will raise my body up from the earth in 3 days." And he did. He said he's coming back again to receive us unto himself. The tomb is empty. If you search the world today, every other tomb has dry bones in it. But the only tomb that is recognized for the emptiness is the tomb that Jesus was laid in. He is not there. He is risen, and he is coming back again as he said he would. Believe the story. The story is true. His disciples did not stole his body. No one could have taken his body. The grave could not hold him captive. The grave could not keep him down. The sealed tomb could not keep him down. The stone that they rolled on the door could not keep him in. There is nothing that could have held his body down, because he had the power to raise it up. And yes, he did. He is risen. The tomb is empty. Because of that, we can shout and we can rejoice. He's coming back again. He lived that we will live also. He lived that we can face our tomorrows and we can trust him with all our heart. We worship him because the tomb is empty and no one stole his body from the tomb. Father, this morning, we thank you for the resurrected Christ. We thank you for the empty tomb. Oh God, if it was not for the empty tomb, Christ's death would have been in vain. But because the tomb is empty this morning, we are here with the privilege and the opportunity that we can rejoice in you, that we can serve our risen Christ, that we can say like the songwriter, "He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walked with me. He talked with me along the narrow way. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart." Father, thank you this morning for the empty tomb in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah.